tolerance. And Rabbit Boris.
Speak in the mic.
Rabbit Boris. Little did I know when we drove from through the Jewish library and to the airport a year and a half ago, or 2 years, that I would have such warm and good feelings about you being here to be our rabbi. So thank you so much. We spent about 2 hours talking in the airport, and he said, I think I better get to my airplane. you speakers usually start their speeches by saying, Come here in, Adria von den Redden, Bella Sultan Abdul-Kerrigan. And though, for those who are Yiddishly challenged, I'll translate.
Tell him to get the mic in.
Before I start to speak, I have to say a few words. Personally, I would like to thank the committee that chose to honor me tonight, as well as to Rabbi Boris, for what I was unsure of taking the honor. He gave me the hechsher to go ahead. But none of them are to blame or to be held responsible for what I'm about to say. It's strictly my mishigas. I want to thank all friends and families who have come to give support to both Roseanne and myself. We both appreciate you being here. In 1981, at a celebration of Mordechai Kaplan's 100th birthday, Rabbi Harold Schulweis started his address by declaring that he wanted to do Hichkatshut, to restore and renew the power and passion to transform all our lives as Jews in the Galut. I too would like to, in my humble way, do Hichkatshut for both Kaplan and our congregation. In the early years, in the 60s and early 70s, we knew we were Reconstructionists. We took seriously Kaplan's definition of Judaism as the evolving religious civilization of the Jewish people. Each word was important, evolving and constantly changing with new ideas. Religion meant commitment to an ideal, and civilization with all the facets of history, art, music, song, and language. In the early 60s, when we brought Kaplan to speak at McGill, he so impressed students that they began coming to our Saturday services. We paved the way in Montreal for egalitarian services and women having aliyot, that worship could have poetry, that 3 aliyot were sufficient for Torah reading, since intent. And some people here take note. Intent is and was more important than perfection. And even the Baal Shem Tov said that if you can't say the words, you then sing or dance. We understood that all of Jewish experience was Torah, even the contemporary. And we debated and discussed these issues and went home invigorated further understanding of events. This openness inspired Jewish students to bring their friends, and among them, Rabbi A.B. Ingbar in Cleveland, Rabbi Douglas Goldhammer in Chicago, Michael Stanislavski, a professor of Jewish studies at Columbia University, Rabbi Roly Madelon in New York, as well as Montreal's own Rabbi Lisa Brushko. By inviting Galbus Shalmi to come and speak to us on Saturday morning and giving her aliyah, her first ever, we inspired her to work with Norma Joseph to start the Women at the Wall movement. We own that. We never use the term Ashirbakarban, as all people are children of the words, and it implies that someone, an anthropomorphic god, was choosing. In 1945, Kaplan was put into harem, and his siddur and haggadah were burned in a New York hotel by the Orthodox, essentially for eliminating chosenness. In 1969, at a convention in New York, students were invited to be full participants in the debates and discussions. When these students were asked the questions, why do we have to be Jewish to be for human rights, to be Jewish for civil rights, for justice, etc.? Kaplan's response was, you can be for human rights in general, you can be for human rights in general, for civil rights in general, for justice in general, and it is like taking a, it is like talking in general without any language in particular. The language of the Jewish people is our experience, our history, and our culture, and we must act from there. I likewise try to do the same. The late Christopher Hitchens, who identified himself as ethnically Jewish, wrote, God is not great. I agree. God of the Torah is not great. He is injudicious like all Hasidic rabbis when he rejects Adam and Eve from Eden for having acquired wisdom. Would we have had Esti and Chaim reading on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur if Shifra and Yochanan had not left Tash? God is a despotic tyrant when he turns Lot's wife into salt, as she turns back to observe the devastation which he, as a homophobic terrorist, wreaks on Sodom and Gomorrah. He burns Nadav and Abihu. He burns Korah, Dotan, and Abraham with 250 followers. In Exodus, even boasts of hardening Pharaoh's heart so he can prove his masculine prowess. He does all this without regard for innocent women and children. For this, every Shabbat we repeat Hacharam HaRachamon seven times. I think I have Rachamonis because I know you're all hungry. So I've tried to cut my rant from over 25 minutes to, I hope, not much more than 10. We as Reconstructionists must reflect how our Torah mythology has led to a Donald Trump in the U.S. and Netanyahu Israel. How do we reconstruct? We have to go back to Kaplan. At a meeting with the Whittier Colorado in the 1960s, Kaplan called for a radical transformation of the synagogue. They should become a Bet HaMidrash, a house of learning, a house of study. Worship to be entirely secondary. From his May 11, 1924 notes, he writes, we believe that a Hebrew poet does not have to be dead at least 700 years before his poetry may be recited in the service. As Canadians, our poetry must also be included. Nathan Alterman's poem, The Silver Platter, has more meaning for reflection than what we read now. Jeremiah's built cities and live in them. Is this not what the settlers are doing and putting up roadblocks to peace? The poets Yehuda Bar Amichai, Rahia were to sing to the Tchaikovsky Sapi Sapi or Shirla Shalom at least every second week, we would all be going home singing the melodies. No, Sharon, the synagogue is not a place for nostalgia. Another plagiarism from Schulweis. Rabbi Simchan Bunin was once asked, why can't you walk in the saintly footsteps of your father? I do. My father didn't walk in his father's footsteps. And I don't walk in my father's. We must make radical change in our liturgy. We must allow science in. When I visited Kaplan in Jerusalem, ever the rabbi and teacher, he made me read Einstein, get that book off the shelf, turn to Einstein. Science without religion is lame, but religion without science is blind. Think of it, 100 years ago, Einstein had a religious faith that there was gravity waves and black holes. And as Dr. Rainer Weiss said, it's really Einstein who won this Nobel Prize. And I wish he were alive so I could congratulate him. As Richard Dawkins says, we have to find science in the soul as we look up to the stars and realize we are observing fire burning hundreds and hundreds of thousands of light years past. Pirkei Avot says, happy is the generation where the old shall listen to the young, for it will surely follow that the young will listen to the old. We must find ways to bring in our alienated young people, not the ones who go to the Mile End or the Backstreet Synagogue, but the ones who do not participate. Last summer at Kles Canada, when we ran both an Orthodox and egalitarian service for Friday Shabbat, these youth, led by Rabbi Shuli Dresner, wanted only to dance, play music, sing Yiddish folk songs, Hebrew modern and Nigunim, English and French, not too much more. And did so with arms around each other and moving in a circle. At that time, I could only think of Rabbi Boris's group in Poland, who are not interested in Tisha B'Av, but wanted to celebrate the joy of rediscovering their Jewish culture. We are Dorshei Emet, seekers of truth. We must be honest with our youth. As Yevtushenko writes, telling lies to the young is wrong. Proving to them that lies are true is wrong. Telling them that God's in his heaven and all's well with the world is wrong. Yes, Rabbi Boris, I have faith. Great faith in the creative powers of our youth. If we can empower them, they will work with us to build a fresh, unique, committed, and a beautiful Judaism, such that there will be no reason to defect, no reason for apostasy. Chazal says, break the flask, but be careful to preserve the wine. We know what the wine is. Let us break the flask. Another Kaplanism. Don't tell me what the synagogue is. Tell me what it ought to be, instead of with his hands up. Don't tell me what Judaism, tell me what it ought to be. Because if you say ought, you have a responsibility to make the ought into reality. I pledge myself to work that end, to work towards that end. And I challenge all to work with me. Rabbi Tarfon said, the road is heavy, I'm sorry, the load is heavy. The road is long. It's not incumbent on us to complete the job, but nor are we exempt from starting it.